Otto Preminger. Otto Ludwig Preminger was an American theater and film director, originally from Austria-Hungary. He directed more than 35 feature films in a five-decade career after leaving the theater. He first gained attention for film noir mysteries such as Laura and Fallen Angel, while in the 1950s and 1960s, he directed a number of high-profile adaptations of popular novels and stage works. Several of these later films pushed the boundaries of censorship by dealing with topics which were then taboo in Hollywood, such as drug addiction, rape and homosexuality. He was twice nominated for the Academy Award for Best Director. He also had a few acting roles. Preminger was born in 1905 in Wisnitz, Bukovina, Austro-Hungarian Empire, into a Jewish family. His parents were Josefa and Marcus Preminger. The couple provided a stable home life for Preminger and his younger brother Ingwald, known as Ingo, later the producer of the original film version of MASH. After the assassination in 1914 of Archduke Franz Ferdinand, which led to the Great War, Rush entered the war on the Serbian side. Like other refugees in flight, Marcus Preminger saw Austria as a safe haven for his family. He secured a position as public prosecutor in Graz, capital of Styria. When the Preminger family relocated, Otto was nearly 9, and was enrolled in a school where instruction in Catholic dogma was mandatory and Jewish history and religion had no place on the syllabus. Ingo, not yet 4, remained at home. After a year in Graz, the decisive public prosecutor was summoned to Vienna, where he was offered an eminent position, roughly equivalent to that of the United States Attorney General. Marcus was told that the position would be his only if he converted to Catholicism, which he refused to do. The next year, he relocated his family to Vienna, where Otto later claimed to have been born. Preminger's first theatrical ambition was to become an actor. In his early teens, he was able to recite from memory many of the great monologues from the international classic repertory, and, never shy, he demanded an audience. Preminger's most successful performance in the National Library Rotunda was Mark Antony's funeral oration from Julius Caesar. As he read, watched, and after a fashion began to produce plays, he began to miss more and more classes in school. When the war came to an end, Marcus formed his own law practice. He instilled in both his sons a sense of fair play as well as respect for those with opposing viewpoints. As his father's practice continued to thrive in post-war Vienna, Otto began seriously contemplating a career in the theater. In 1923, when Preminger was 17, his soon-to-be mentor, Max Reinhardt, the renowned Viennese-born director, announced plans to establish a theatrical company in Vienna. Reinhardt's announcement was seen as a call of destiny to Preminger. He began writing to Reinhardt weekly, requesting an audition. After a few months, Preminger, frustrated, gave up, and stopped his daily visit to the post office to check for a response. Unbeknownst to him, a letter was waiting with a date for an audition which Preminger had already missed by 2 days. He juggled a commitment to university and to his new position as a Reinhardt apprentice. The two developed a mentor and protege relationship, becoming both a confidant and teacher. When the theater opened, on April 1, 1924, Preminger appeared as a furniture mover in Reinhardt's comedic staging of Carlo Goldoni's The Servant of Two Masters. His next appearance came the next month with William Dieterle in The Merchant of Venice. Other notable alumni with whom Preminger would work the same year were Matty Christians, who died of a stroke after having been blacklisted during the McCarthy era, and Nora Greger, who was to star in Jean Renoir's La Règle du Jeu. The following summer, a frustrated Preminger was no longer content to occupy the place of a subordinate and he decided to leave the Reinhardt fold. His status as a Reinhardt muse gave him an edge over much of his competition when it came to joining German-speaking theater. His first theater assignments as a director in Osijek were plays ranging from the sexually provocative Lulu plays, and from Berlin he imported War China, a pro-communist agitprop. In 1930, a wealthy industrialist from Graz approached Otto with an offer to direct a film called Die große Liebe. Preminger did not have the same passion for the medium as he had for theater. He accepted the assignment nonetheless. The film premiered at the Emperor Theater in Vienna on December 21, 1931, to strong reviews and business. From 1931-35, he directed 26 shows. On August 3, 1932, he wed a Hungarian woman, Marion Mill. The couple married only 30 minutes after her divorce from her first husband had been finalized. In April 1935, as Preminger was rehearsing a boulevard farce, The King with an Umbrella, he received a summons from American film producer Joseph Schenck to a 5 o'clock meeting at the Imperial Hotel. Schenck and partner, Daryl F. Zanuck, co-founders of 20th Century Fox, were on the lookout for new talent. Within a half hour of meeting Schenck, Preminger accepted an invitation to work for Fox in Los Angeles. Preminger's first assignment was to direct a vehicle for Lawrence Tippett. Preminger worked efficiently, completing the film well within the budget and well before the scheduled shooting deadline. The film opened to tepid notices in November 1936. Zanuck gave Preminger the task of directing another B-picturesque group all-comedy film Danger, Love at Work. Simone Simon was cast but later fired by Zanuck and replaced with Ann Southern. The premise was that eight members of an eccentric, wealthy family have inherited their grandfather's land, and the protagonist is a lawyer tasked with persuading the family to hand the land over to a corporation that believes there is oil on the property. One of the female members of the wealthy family provides the romantic interest. In November 1937, Zanuck's perennial emissary Gregory Radoff brought Preminger the news that Zanuck had selected him to direct Kidnapped, which was to be the most expensive feature to date for 20th Century Fox. Zanuck himself had adapted the Robert Louis Stevenson novel. After reading Zanuck's script, Preminger knew he was in trouble since he would be a foreign director directing in a foreign setting. During the shooting of Kidnapped, while screening footage of the film with Zanuck, the studio had accused Preminger of making changes in a scene, in particular, one with child actor Freddie Bartholomew and a dog. Preminger, composed at first, explained, claiming he shot the scene exactly as written. Zanuck insisted that he knew his own script. The confrontation escalated and ended with Preminger exiting the office and slamming the door. Days later, the lock to Preminger's office was changed, and his name was removed from the door. Later, a representative of Zanuck offered Preminger a buyout deal which he rejected. Preminger wanted to be paid for the remaining 11 months of his two-year contract. He searched for work at other studios, but received no offers. Only 2 years after his arrival in Hollywood, he was unemployed in the film industry. He returned to New York, and began to refocus on the stage. Success came quickly on Broadway for Preminger, with long-running productions, including Outward Bound with Laurette Taylor and Vincent Price, My Dear Children with John and Elaine Barrymore, and Margin for Error, in which Preminger played a shiny dome villainous Nazi. Preminger was offered a teaching position at the Yale School of Drama and began commuting twice a week to Connecticut to lecture on directing and acting. William Goetz, who was running Fox in Zanuck's absence, was soon impressed with Preminger and offered him a new 7-year contract, calling on his services as both a director and actor. Preminger took full measure of the temporary studio czar, and accepted. He completed production on schedule, although with a slightly increased budget, by November 1942. Critics were dismissive upon the film's release the following February, noting the bad timing of the release, coinciding with the war. Before his next assignment with Fox, Preminger was asked by movie mogul Samuel Goldwyn to appear as a Nazi once more, this time in a Bob Hope comedy, They Got Me Covered. Preminger hoped to find possible properties he could develop before Zanuck's return, one of which was Vera Caspary's suspense novel Laura. Before production would begin on Laura, Preminger was given the green light to produce and direct Army Wives, another B-picture morale booster for a country at war. Its focus was on showing the sacrifices made by women as they send their husbands off to the front. Zanuck returned from the armed services with his grudge against Preminger intact. Preminger was not granted permission to direct Laura, only to serve as producer. Ruben Mamoulian was selected to direct. Mamoulian began ignoring Preminger and started to rewrite the script. Although Preminger had no complaints about the casting of the relatively unknown Gene Tierney and Dana Andrews, he balked at their choice for the film's villain, Waldo, actor Laird Krieger. Preminger explained to Zanuck that audiences would immediately identify Krieger as a villain, especially after Krieger's role as Jack the Ripper in The Lodger. Preminger wanted stage actor Clifton Webb to play Waldo and persuaded his boss to give Webb a screen test. Webb was cast and Mamoulian was fired for creative differences. Laura started filming on April 27, 1944, with a projected budget of $849,000. After Preminger took over, the film continued shooting well into late June. When released, the film was an instant hit with audiences and critics alike, earning Preminger his first Academy Award nomination for direction. Preminger expected acclaim for Laura would promote him to work on better pictures, but his professional fate was in the hands of Zanuck, who had Preminger take over for the ailing Ernst Lubitsch on A Royal Scandal, a remake of Lubitsch's own Silent Forbidden Paradise, starring Pola Negri as Catherine the Great. Before he suffered a heart attack, Lubitsch had spent months in preparation, and had already cast the film. Preminger cast Tallulah Bankhead, whom he had known since 1938 when he was directing on Broadway. Bank had learned that Preminger's family would be barred from emigrating to the U.S. due to immigration quotas, and she asked her father to intervene to save them from the Nazis. He did, which earned Bankhead Preminger's loyalty. Thus, when Lubitsch wanted to make the film and tow a vehicle for Greta Garbo, Preminger, although he would have been eager to direct the film that brought Garbo out of retirement, refused to betray Bankhead. They became good friends and got along well during filming. The film received generally lackluster reviews as the Ruritanian romance genre had become outdated, and it failed to earn back any gross revenue. Fallen Angel was exactly what Preminger had been anticipating. In Fallen Angel, a con man and womanizer ends up by chance in a small California town, where he romances a sultry waitress and a well-to-do spinster. When the waitress is found killed, the drifter, played by Dana Andrews, becomes the prime suspect. Linda Darnell played the doomed waitress. Centennial Summer, Preminger's next film, would be his first shot entirely in color. The reviews and box office draw were tepid when the film was released in July 1946, but by the end of that year Preminger had one of the most sumptuous contracts on the lot, earning $7,500 a week. Forever Amber, based on Kathleen Windsor's internationally popular novel published in 1944, was Zanuck's next investment in adaptation. Preminger had read the book and disliked it immensely. Preminger had another bestseller aimed at a female audience in mind, Daisy Kenyon. Zanuck pledged that if Preminger did Forever Amber first, he could go to town with Daisy Kenyon afterwards. Forever Amber had already been shooting for nearly 6 weeks when Preminger replaced director John Stahl. Zanuck had already spent nearly $2 million on the production. Only after turning to his revised script did Preminger learn Zanuck had recast Linda Darnell. Zanuck was convinced that whoever played Amber would become a big star, and he wanted that woman to be one of the studio's own. Zanuck had bought the book because he believed its scandalous reputation promised big box office returns, and was not surprised when the Catholic Legion of Decency condemned the film for glamorizing a promiscuous heroine who has a child out of wedlock, and successfully lobbied 20th Century Fox to make changes to the film. Forever Amber opened to big business in October 1947, and garnered decent reviews. Preminger called the film the most expensive picture I ever made, and it was also the worst. Preminger maintained a busy schedule, working with writers on scripts for two planned projects, Daisy Kenyon and The Dark Wood. The latter was not produced. Joan Crawford starred in Daisy Kenyon alongside Dana Andrews, Ruth Warwick, and Henry Fonda. Variety proclaimed the film high-powered melodrama surefire for the femme market. After the modest success of Daisy Kenyon, Preminger saw that Lady in Ermine is a further opportunity. Betty Grable was cast opposite Douglas Fairbanks Jr. The film had previously been another Lubitsch project, but after Lubitsch's sudden death in November 1947, Preminger took over. His next film was a period piece based on Lady Windermere's fan. Over the spring and early summer of 1948, Preminger turned Oscar Wilde's play Into the Fan, which starred Madeline Carroll. The film opened to poor notices. Several of his films in this period dealt with controversial and taboo topics, thereby challenging both the Motion Picture Association of America's production code of censorship and the Hollywood blacklist. The Catholic Legion of Decency condemned the comedy The Moon is Blue on the grounds of morale standards. Based on a Broadway play which had inspired mass protests for its use of the words virgin and pregnant, the film was released without the production code seal of approval. Based on the novel by Nelson Algren, The Man with the Golden Arm was one of the first Hollywood films to deal with heroin addiction. Later, Anatomy of a Murder, with its frank courtroom discussions of rape and sexual intercourse, led to the censors objecting to the use of words such as rape, sperm, sexual climax, and penetration. Preminger made but one concession, and the picture was released with IMPA seal, marking the beginning of the end of the production code. With Exodus, Preminger struck a first major blow against Hollywood blacklist by acknowledging banned screenwriter Dalton Trumbo. The film is an adaptation of the Leon Uris bestseller about the founding of State of Israel. Preminger also acted in a few movies, including the World War II Luftstallach Commandant, Oberst von Skirbich of the German POW Camp Stallach 17 Inches, directed by Billy Wilder. From the mid-1950s, most of Preminger's films used animated titles designed by Saul Bass, and many had jazz scores. At the New York City Opera, in October 1953, Preminger directed the American premiere of Gottfried von Einem's Opera Der Prozess, based on Franz Kafka's novel The Trial. Soprano Phyllis Curtin headed the cast. Preminger also adapted two operas for the screen during the decade. Carmen Jones is a reworking of the Buse opera Carmen to a wartime African-American setting, while Porgy and Bess is based on the George Gershwin opera. His two films of the early 1960s were Advice and Consent, a political drama from the Alan Drury bestseller with a homosexual sub-theme, and The Cardinal, a drama set in the Vatican hierarchy for which Preminger received his second Best Director Academy Award nomination. Laurence Olivier, who played a police inspector in the psychological thriller Bunny Lake Is Missing, shot in England, recalled in his autobiography Confessions of an Actor that he found Preminger a bully. Adam West, who portrayed the lead in the 1960s Batman television series, echoed Olivier's opinion. He remembered Preminger, who played Mr. Freeze, as being rude and unpleasant, especially when he disregarded the typical thespian etiquette of subtly cooperating when being helped to his feet, in a scene by West and Burt Ward. Beginning in 1965, Preminger made a string of films in which he attempted to make stories that were fresh and distinctive, but the films he made, including In Harm's Way and Tell Me That You Love Me, Junie Moon, became both critical and financial flops. Preminger's Hurry Sundown is a lengthy drama set in the U.S. South and was partly intended to break cinematic racial and sexual taboos. However, the film was poorly received and ridiculed for a heavy-handed approach, and for the dubious casting of Michael Caine as an American Southerner. Hurry Sundown signaled a decline in Preminger's reputation, as it was followed by several other films which were critical and commercial failures, including Ski-Doo, a failed attempt at a hip 60s comedy, and Rosebud, a terrorism thriller which was also widely ridiculed. Several publicized disputes with leading actors did further damage to Preminger's reputation. His last film, an adaptation of the Graham Greene espionage novel The Human Factor, had financial problems and was barely released. The Academy Film Archive has preserved several of Otto Preminger's films, including The Man with the Golden Arm, The Moon is Blue, and Advice and Consent. Preminger and his wife Marion became increasingly estranged. He lived like a bachelor, as was the case when he met burlesque performer Gypsy Rose Lee and began an open relationship with her. Lee had already attempted to break into movie roles, but she was not taken seriously as anything more than a stripper. She appeared in B-pictures in less than minor roles. Preminger's liaison with Lee produced a child, Eric. Lee rejected the idea of Preminger helping to support the child, instead eliciting a vow of silence from Preminger. He was not to reveal Eric's paternity to anyone, including Eric himself. Lee called the boy Eric Kirkland after her husband, Alexander Kirkland, from whom she was separated at the time. It was not until 1966, when Preminger was 60 years old and Eric was 22, that father and son finally met. In May 1946, Marion asked for a divorce, after meeting a wealthy Swedish financier, Axel Wennergren. The Premingers' divorce ended smoothly and speedily. She did not seek alimony, only personal belongings. Axel's wife, however, was unwilling to grant a divorce. Marion returned to Otto and resumed appearances as his wife, and nothing more. Preminger had begun dating Natalie Draper, a niece of Marion Davis. While filming Carmen Jones, Preminger began an affair with the film's star, Dorothy Dandridge, which lasted 4 years. During that period he advised her on career matters, including an offer made to Dandridge for the featured role of Tuptim in the film of The King and I. Preminger advised her to turn it down as he believed it unworthy of her. She later regretted taking his advice. Preminger died in New York City in 1986, aged 80, from lung cancer while suffering from Alzheimer's disease. He was cremated and is interred in a niche in the Azalea Room of the Velma B. Woolworth Memorial Chapel at Woodlawn Cemetery, The Bronx, New York. Preminger's Anatomy of a Murder was nominated for an Academy Award for Best Picture. He was twice nominated for Best Director, for Laura and for The Cardinal. He won the Bronze Berlin Bear Award for the film Carmen Jones at the 5th Berlin International Film Festival. Journals Books. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.